Hi, if you've been making games for a while, I'm sure that you already know that things can get messy really quickly. That's why I've prepared for you 9 tips for less crappy games. Hope this will help you out with an easier game development and faster debugging. Let's get started. Here is a simple point and click game I made as a tutorial on this channel. You can see it in the top right corner. And we're gonna use it as an example of a crappy game, but only in some places. Basically, all you have to do here is to collect items, use them in the correct order, and eventually escape with the Senna. If you would like to work on this example, you can download it from the link in the description. The first problem is that as we start the game, at the beginning everything looks fine, but as we pick the first item up, you get this type of error. We have our items from the previous run. That's because we use a static list of items. That's a great way to store collected items, but with every static variable, you need to make sure that you clear it as you restart the level or you restart the whole game. So if we hit the restart button, we call this restart game function, go to the very first scene and also clear our equipment. Alright, the second tip is a tiny one because all I want to say is that you should always think about the resolution of your game, especially if it's a mobile one. Here we have the main menu. But if we change the resolution to a bigger one, it's still 16:9. Our menu keeps getting smaller and smaller. And to easily fix it, you need to find your canvas. And if it's screen space overlay render mode, you need to change its UI scale mode to scale with screen size. There you put your original resolution. Now everything is fine as long as we keep the same aspect ratio. Now it's 16:9, but if we go to 21:10, our screen gets cropped a little bit and we don't see this bottom text. So if you want to be able to change the aspect ratio too and don't make your game crappy, you need to make sure that everything that's important fits in this area. If your canvas is set to world space, you don't need to touch anything here because you won't get this problem. And you even can't do anything in the canvas scaler. Speaking of the UI, in this project I use canvas to trigger some actions. For example, if the player clicks on a plant, the player character goes to it, and if the player hovers the mouse over the plant, it shows its name. Going to a plant takes a while and you can do things in the meantime. So the third tip is that if you have something in your game that needs more than one frame to execute, you need to make sure that it won't be broken if the player does something else in the meantime. For example, that's how we walk normally. We click once and we go to a painting. But if we click multiple times on the plant, we start going really quickly and sometimes you can really break your game. So here is an example of a function that causes the error, and we click on an item, we want to go to it, do our things, and the most important part here is that start coroutine, which moves our player to an item. This takes some time, and there is nothing to stop us from going to this item again, or maybe another item. If we want to go to this item again, for example, we double click on it, we call another coroutine, the previous one is still running, so we move at double speed, and after that, we try getting this item 2 times. And if we can get this item, we get 2 items. In my case, the best solution is to use this player walking boolean, which tells us if the player is currently walking towards a given target or not. And simply let it happen only if the player is not walking. Then somewhere in the code we set it to false, and we are ready to go to another item. As you can see, now it's protected. If for some reason it's not a proper solution for you, you can create a canvas with a render mode set to screen space overlay, and inside create a new UI image, change its anchor to this bottom right corner while holding the Alt key to make it cover up the whole screen. Now make sure that its raycast target is turned on, and if you want to block clicking on things, you just make it enabled, and if you don't want it anymore, you make it disabled. But before you start playing the game, you also need to change its alpha to 0. Now the player doesn't know that something is blocked. But it's still blocking because the raycast target is turned on. If you'd like to, you can change raycast target option instead. As you can see, even in a relatively simple game like this one, you have a lot of things to think about. So the next tip is to keep your code organized. And what I mean by saying that is to use, for example, headers to keep your variables in place, and also to have some comments in your functions to know what is going on inside the function, and also to name your functions properly. For example, we have this moveToPoint, and we know that this function only moves a given object to a given point. We don't want anything else. In this function, I also flip the object to face the target. I think it's okay to leave it there, but I also check if the object I'm currently moving is the player. So what I want to say is that you can do that because it saves you a lot of time, but the price is that this function gets a little bit more complicated. Now I need to keep in mind that moveToPoint function also changes player walking boolean if the player arrives to the point. Another tip is related to what I've done to this item data. Here I have name text size and item name text size. And those are default values of it. And every time I want to add a new item with a name and a hint, I need to set the proper size to fit this text. It's super easy to program, but imagine that you are working on a city builder with thousands of buildings, roads, and any items to put on a map. And now you need to set a proper size of your name tag every time you create a new object. My tip for you is to think about ways of removing those variables as your game gets bigger. For microgames, it's not a problem at all. So here is what we need to create. We need to have a function which returns a vector2 type variable and needs a string to function. So we can see in this part of the code that we use something like hintMessage. And there we use item.hintBoxSize. So instead of hintBoxSize, we want to use textBoxSize and use item.hintMessage there. That's our string. If all of your messages take only one line, you don't need to touch anything here. But if you want something more advanced, you need to write something like that. This line of code splits your string into many strings based on this character. This is a special one which divides your text into many lines. And now we just multiply line height by lines.length. Now we're gonna find the biggest line of them. Okay, so we looped through our lines, and if the current line is longer than the number of our characters, we modify this variable. Now we don't need a default x, so let's rename it. Now it's character width, and we want to multiply it by max characters. If you want this function to work perfectly, use monospaced fonts, but if you want it just to work fine, simply use short text. Then the text box padding will change, but it won't be visible with the short text. And if in your game every text in a box has a different font size, you need to add another argument over there and simply multiply the x value by this float. Now to make it work, you need to do something like this. So first we grab a Text Mesh Pro component, and then we use the string we want to put in the box, and also the font size of this Text Mesh Pro component. As you can see, it works properly and there is nothing related to the text box size in the item data. Another tip is that if you are working on an UI system, you want to pay close attention to this raycast target option. If the object you work on is not interactable but gives you some information, for example this name tag, you want to set this option to disabled. But it's not over. If we move our mouse in a specific way, you can see that this name tag blinks. That's because we have this raycast target turned on, but in some other places. Usually you need to check its child objects. Here I have Text Mesh Pro, and I need to open this tab, and there is raycast target option. Now I disable it. And everything is fine now. Another cool thing is that you can use enums to make your work easier. For example, in the item data, I have item ID and required item ID. And in Unity, it looks like this. I have plant, its item ID is 1, and it requires item 0. There is water, and its item ID is 0, and required item is minus 1. I know that it means we need a bottle of water to give it to the plant, because its required item ID is 0, but sometimes it's hard to remember, so the better solution is to create public enum items over there and just add all of the items we have in the game here. Now we can change this integer type to items. We get some errors, so first we need to fix them before changing anything here. So instead of this minus 1, which tells me that an item doesn't need any items to be picked up, I use items in item data dot none. Now this is items type and that's integer type, so I go to game manager and change selected item ID. Now we start the game with nothing selected and it's clearly visible. I've made a little mess in this function because of those integers, but now it will look way better if we use enums. Now instead of numbers, which don't tell us much, we have a clear list of items in our game. So for example, you have this plant, so it's a plant and it requires water. The last two tips for you are about not making your work unnecessarily harder. Here I have a small class for the name tag, and basically all it does is following the mouse. But to achieve it, we need to get mouse position, which is easy, the resolution, which needs to be found, and the resolution in game units, which needs to be found in a weird way. So we spent a good while finding those numbers and figuring this out. And thanks to an awesome viewer from this channel, thank you buddy, I understood that there is a way better solution. Unity has a built-in function for all of that, and what do you need is a camera component. You need to find it. I have only one camera, so I use find object of type and just use my camera dot screen to word point, and here use input dot mouse position, and that's it. We don't need this line, we don't need this line, and it takes basically no time compared to the previous solution. Oh, and because it's a 2D game, we don't want to touch a Z position of this transform, so we simply change it to vector 2. As you can see, everything looks fine. If we don't use vector 2 here, our Z position is minus 10, just like the camera's Z position. And that means we don't see anything because it's in word space and it's at the same place as the camera. Okay, here's the last tip. We see the water bottle over here, but as it comes to the plant, we don't see anything. And that's because if we pick the plant up, we destroy it. Not just a silly mistake of a programmer, which is me, and I don't want to touch programming, so I'm going to think about other solution for this problem. Let's see, we have a plant and it destroys itself, which means it destroys its item data, which holds its name, so we can access it. We could do something in the code to save this component, or at least its name, but we can do this the easy way, which means just creating a new empty game object, leaving its position at 0, you can hit reset over there to make sure, and just move the visual representation of this object to the child object. Just copy components, remove them, and paste them as new. Now the only broken thing is that missing sprite renderer, which is this component. And that's our plant body. What is important over there is that we don't touch anything which is inside the script, and we don't move the script itself, so we don't need to look at things like plant UI image, which holds mouse events. And now we simply destroy plant body instead of the plant itself. Let's see if this small change solves the problem. Okay, let's change its required item ID to be able to pick it up. And yeah, now we see its name. Hope this video was useful for you. Have a good day and see you soon.